Thank you. Thank you very much. I feel a little embarrassed by the extremely scholarly lecture of the previous speaker. I'm afraid what I have to say will be of a rather personal nature, and it will be rather fuller of levitas than gravitas. It's a great honor to have been asked to give this talk. My advantage is that I've been here a long time, but this has the disadvantage that my memory is increasingly unreliable. As they say, the oldest inhabitants who can never remember anything. So I am particularly grateful to Anne Barrett for her help with dates and other matters. I'm also so happy that Philip Davis and Paul Mallevin, world-famous mathematician and long-term friends of this college, are gracing our proceedings. The year 1955 is an important date in the history of our department. It is the year when Harry Jones became acting head, and a year later head. He did more than anybody else to determine the modern shape of our department. Before him, we had distinguished mathematicians, such as Whitehead and Chapman and Forsyth, whom we are honoring today. However, I believe that it was Jones who created a distinguished department. I'd like to put up a brief time scale to give you an impression of the people who were heads at various times. You see, Harry Jones was the longest serving head. He served for 15 years. And Linstead was at that time rector, followed by Penny, followed by Flowers, followed by Ash, and by Sir Ronald Oxborough, whom we're very happy to have with us today. And here are the heads of departments. We acquired 52-53 Princes Gate in 1964, I think. And we moved to W2, the new building, the new Huxley building, in 1975. So these are some important dates. Anne Barrett has reported to us about earlier times. I never met Chapman, but I've been told that he was extremely careful with the college's money. A paperclip could only be given out if a convincing case had been made. His successor, Hyman Levy, was a very charming person. I have never seen more enthusiasm than the time when he received this fellowship of the college. He has given some delightful lectures on TV about his early years in Glasgow. He was head of department from 1946 to 1954, as we've heard. Later, he used to come to departmental parties, and it was always a delight to talk to him. He was a convinced communist and used to run the Daily Worker from the departmental office. There is also a malicious rumor that when appointing new members of staff, he was sometimes more concerned with their political correctness than their mathematical eminence. However, both qualities were combined in the case of George Barnard, who came to IC in 1945, became professor of statistics in 1954, and stayed until he went to Essex in 1966. I'd just like to put up, while I'm doing this, some pictures of heads of department that I've been given. I think we've already seen, I take this off for the time being. I think we've already seen Hyman Levy, but I think that must have been when he was a little younger than when I knew him. Next, we have Harry Jones, who was around when people will recognize him. I think that's really how he looked. Again, I think a little younger than perhaps some of us knew him. His successor as head of department was David Cox. Those of us who see him today will recognize that he hasn't changed a bit. Very nice to have you with us, David. Following that, we had Trevor Stewart, who I gather is across the Atlantic seeing his grandson, who did a lot for the department in applied mathematics. Then there was Harry Reuter, who was a very, very nice, amiable and pleasant person, and who kept the department together and made it a really friendly place. Then we have Frank Leppington, who was a gamekeeper, or rather poacher turned gamekeeper. He used to be in charge of the AUT and was a very virulent worker for our rights, but then he turned out to be a very virulent worker for the rights of the maths department after he became head of department too. And finally, we have Professor Adrian Smith, who some of you may have seen earlier today. Just to remind you who he is. Good. A very nice present head leading us on to greatness. I leave this up now. Okay. So let me continue. Well, Barnard, I mentioned Barnard, he built up statistics at IC, but the process was continued by his successor, Sir David Cox, who was head of department from 1970 to 74. I mentioned Stewart from 74 to 79 and 83 to 86. Reuter from 79 to 83 in between. Leppington from 86 to 92, when he was succeeded by our present head, Adrian Smith. When Livy retired in 1954, Barnard and Jones were the professors. Harry Jones was determined to build up the department to be more than an ancillary department for the scientists and engineers, which is essentially what it had been until then. I mean, we did have honors students, but I think that the ancillary activities were probably the main thrust of what the department did before this. Well, he came to lecture to our seminar in Exeter in the autumn of 1955, and afterwards we talked about his department. He told us that there was a professor of statistics as well as one of applied mathematics. I asked him whether he didn't want a professor of pure mathematics, and he replied, "College had always managed very well without such a person." However, he must have had second thoughts, since a few months later, the chair was advertised. I was told they were interested in me, but I didn't apply. I just bought a new house and had not yet sold my old one. We were very happy in Exeter. And when we married, we had sworn never to live in London. So I didn't think about it anymore, in spite of a few hints from A.T. Price, our professor of applied maths, who had been a reader at IC from 46 to 51, and who was still in touch. Then one night, I dreamed that there was a letter offering me the job. I told Margaret about it at breakfast, and sure enough, when I got to college, there was a letter from Jones asking me to come discuss the matter. That was fate. And apart from a gap of 10 years of semi-retirement in Margaret's beloved Yorkshire, I've been here ever since. British institutions are not, on the whole, keen to hang on to their staffs. Vice-chancellors seem to form a cartel and don't bid each other up. So J.W. Cook said to me he didn't wish to stand in my way. I asked whether there was a chance of a personal chair. He said no. I said, could I be pre-appointed to succeed the present head, T. Arnold Brown, when he retired in 1958? Cook said, they couldn't commit themselves so far ahead. There might be some much better people by then. So I accepted my fate. The interview in London was very pleasant. I stayed with Harry Jones and Molly and was particularly impressed with their lifestyle. We had a nice, leisurely breakfast. At about 9:30, Harry suggested we might stroll across the park to IC. There I was interviewed by Blackett and Linstead, and they essentially offered me the job. I even squeezed two concessions from them. One was a salary of £200 above the minimum, and the second was an orchestra where Margaret could play her violin, for which Linstead suggested the Richmond Local Orchestra. So there's no further objection from her, and we arrived in October 1956, together with Jim Clooney from Kiel, who was later promoted to reader and professor and greatly strengthened our group. Harry also wanted to strengthen the theoretical physics section, and so at about the same time he brought in Abdus Salam together with Paul Matthews as reader. Later Dick Scorer headed Applied Maths. I'm glad to see Dick is with us today, and was succeeded by Trevor Stewart, who built up a very distinguished group in that general area. Theoretical physics continued to flourish under Peter Wolfart and later David Edwards, Colin Atkinson, John Gibbon, and John Elgin. The maths department had been a little one-sided in its composition. This gradually changed. Statistics expanded, and in the pure section, we acquired algebraists, Wagner, Baumsler, Keating, Pretzel, and Guggenheim and Berg in topology. We also got more complex analysts, particularly Noel Baker and Thomas Kovary. Numerical analysis received a boost when the London University Center was dissolved, and we were very lucky to acquire Mike Bernal. We were also fortunate to appoint Ortiz, who spans numerical analysis as well as pure maths and history. Not all our appointments were equally successful, but I remember only one who actually had to be asked to go. He'd had quite severe mental and drug problems, but we felt he should be given a chance. He came to believe that he had a logical technique which would solve all problems, such as the Riemann hypothesis, Fermat, etc. One day he was discovered in the common room, lying on a sofa, and saying this was clearly much more important than the lecture he was supposed to be giving. Regretfully, we had to disagree. George Wittrow was a historian of mathematics as well as an astronomer. Cecily Tanner, born Cecily Young, was a complex analyst as well as librarian and historian of mathematics. She and Wittrow ran a very successful and popular history of mathematics seminar. There were strong links with the history and philosophy of science department started by Rupert and Mary Hall in 1963. The department moved out of the old Huxley building into the new Huxley building in 1975. The old place had a slow and dangerous lift in which I believe one person actually fell to his death. It belonged to the Victoria and Albert Museum and reverted to them as the coal wing. The move to the new building of W2 was a great success thanks to the careful planning, particularly by David Edwards and Alexandra Mills, who supported him. There were problems, particularly when great cracks appeared on the west side, but great opportunities were also seized. One was a splendid library, so ably built up by Irina Pindelska and her successor Adrian Clark. Later, the Science Museum Library became almost part of the college. With CD-ROM, almost any paper, past or present, can be conjured up. Another facility I would like to single out is the common room. In the old Huxley building, it was possible to brew up tea, but it was always very difficult to get anybody to do it. In the new Huxley common room, Limited food and drink began to be available, but only at certain hours, morning coffee, lunch, and tea. Now we have food and drink at all times, and all through the day, people from maths and computing can be seen talking. Alas, we can no longer smoke inside. But global warming usually makes it possible to go outside. Telephone and Xerox systems have steadily improved, and virtually everybody, except a few antediluvian fogies, has a computer and is on email. I am told that even some of the fogies are learning about email. When I first came, we just had a few calculators which depended on the handle being turned sufficiently quickly. And Barrett has told us about the Holovith machine. We did, however, have Fred Spillman, an excellent and most helpful technician who made reprints and helped with various experiments. His work expanded and is now most ably done by Jeff Reason and Reg Pereira. We academics sometimes forget how much the smooth running of our department depends on many other people. Moving the post, keeping things clean, looking after our security. But above all, I should like to thank our secretaries. When I first came, I shared a secretary with Bernard. Whenever I asked her to do anything whatever, she was always occupied by doing a most important job for Professor Bernard. This is, of course, completely in contrast to the present. I remember with particular gratitude and affection Vivian Glover, now Harris Bass, Pat Edge, Betsy Hamilton, and Jane Brown, as well as the chief secretaries, Stella Thomas and Helen Hodgson, succeeded by Rosemary Frischer and now Vanessa Perrin. One initiative that Rodney Coleman and I ran from January 72 to March 77 was the sixth form math club. Young pupils from London schools used to come on Thursday afternoons and listen to lectures interspersed with tea, lemonade, and cakes in the library 53 Prince's Gate and later the common room. I used to buy the cakes from Woolworths on the way to college. I believe we used to get up to about 100 to come to hear lectures on insect swarms by Richard Storer. Score on meteorology by John Mason, as well as people from industry like Hooker from Rolls-Royce. However, the spring term was always more difficult, and one icy day, only five boys and no speaker turned up. We rather lost heart at that point and abandoned the project a little later. I should say that one term Rodney Coleman was absent and Agnes Herzberg took his place. Well, in the early days, Harry Jones was very much the head. And Salam and I, and to a lesser extent Barnard, were in awe of him. At that time, heads of departments did not rotate. It reminds me about the story of someone asking what went on in Princeton University. Did they have rotating heads? And the reply was, "He'd be a brave man who'd try to rotate left sheds." But democracy was on its way, and the AOT was agitating. And at about 1970, it was decided that it would be better to have heads of department only for a period and not for life. Well, anyway, in the beginning, the four of us, that's Jones, Barnard, Salam, and I used to have professorial meetings, but it was in the end Jones who decided. It's perhaps worth commenting on the living conditions for young professors in those days. Salam and I both came to live in Campion Road, Putney. There, one could buy a semi-detached house with five bedrooms on the first floor for 1.5 times our annual salary. I don't think you could do that now. Perhaps it was partly that so many people had moved out of London during the war and that London prices were not much higher than those outside. But even then, to get something with a view was more difficult and expensive. It's a good deal harder for young academics now, and in most cases, husbands and wives must both work to make a reasonable living for the family. This is welcomed by many couples, but particularly if the children are young, it is good to have the choice of one partner staying at home. The 50s and 60s were a good time for universities, and after the Robbins Report, expansion was in the air. As I remarked earlier, we had been largely a feeder department. Every member of Imperial College took some maths lectures given in our department. I think that's probably still the case, except perhaps for the medicos. This justified and still justifies the size of our department. But under the leadership of Harry Jones, the honors group began to expand from the 30 or so a year to closer 100. Now I think it's well over 100 a year. The degree also became more rounded with a stronger emphasis on statistics and pure maths. Barnard started a second course with more statistics, but perhaps because of its name, the B course was never very popular. I mean, who would want to go to the B course and when they could go to the A course? This reminds me of a story of Salam. I once asked Salam, when we were getting quite friendly, whether he wanted to be called Salam or Abdus. And he said, Abdus Salam means servant of God. Would you rather be called servant or God? Well, we had this B course and for a few years, and people used to take it in 5253 Princes Gate, which is the building that Barnard had helped the college to acquire. That was a very good bargain. We started having many more options in the third year and later in the second year. When I arrived, we had good pure mathematicians in Leo Roth, who has already been mentioned, Morris Austin, and Yael Dauker. Roth was an old-fashioned geometer with a number of textbooks to his credit and a high reputation in his own discipline. Austin was a real analyst and a magnificent teacher. When I first came, I was advised to sit in on his lectures to first-year students with great profit to myself. Ken Binmore, now professor of economics at UCL, was one of Austin's PhD students. But I learned most from Yael Dauker. I'm glad she's here today. One of her students is Bill Perry, FRS, now at Warwick. Yael was always full of good ideas, which I tried to carry out as best I could. We first had a seminar at the traditional time of Wednesday afternoon, but she suggested we should also have a baby seminar on Monday mornings at 11, preceded by coffee and followed by lunch, where we could give, in successive weeks, one or more lectures on some topics to teach each other as well as to have outside speakers. The baby seminar was an immediate success, and the Wednesday afternoon seminar faded out. Most of the staff and students with interests in analysis or number theory came, but we tried to grab any interesting mathematicians, whatever his area, such as Eilenberg, as well. So we weren't confined just to analysis. Normally we only met in term time, but there were exceptions. Gaston Julia, the co-founder of iteration theory, talked to us on Easter Monday. It was quite difficult to arrange, but we had a good audience. A less happy occasion was when Albert Edrey was hoping to spend a sabbatical year with us, but collapsed with a heart attack during his talk to our seminar. He spent a lot of the session in the London clinic, but he made a full recovery, and now, 30 years later and in his 80s, he's still going strong. So I think anybody who's had a heart attack can take heart from that. On another occasion, Jean Dieudonné gave a lecture. Perhaps it was in the history seminar. He divided the blackboard neatly into two parts. On one side was everything that was good mathematics, i.e. Bourba Key, and on the other side was everything that was done at IC. Complex analysis, number theory, etc. We had the seminar in the old Huxley building in those days, in my office. A room roughly 24 feet cube, and easily able to accommodate us all. There was a cubby hole at the back, where kettle and the cups were kept, and we had a rota of two of us to wash up. I tried to arrange the rota so that a member of staff and a student shared, and I hope some friendships resulted. I feel strongly that a lecture should be preceded or followed by a meal. This was not quite so common in those days as it is now. I remember returning to Cambridge from an LMS lecture as a student and sharing the carriage with a lecturer, Angus Taylor. No hospitality of any sort had been arranged for him. I am glad that things are very different now at the LMS and elsewhere. Meetings and seminars are, after all, social occasions and should be seen as such. I learned a lot about arranging seminars from T. Arnold Brown, my old head at Exeter. All the staff, pure and applied, used to come to the weekly tea and then the lecture. Brown always asked a question at the end to show an interest, and I try to encourage my students and colleagues to do the same now, being particularly successful in this with Thomas Kovary and Milne Anderson. It doesn't matter in the least if you make a fool of yourself. One should avoid trying to make a fool of the lecturer. We got a fair number of overseas students, most of which got on with us very happily. An exception was a prospective student from South Africa. He came to our seminar, and afterwards I asked one of the others to show him the ropes. He happened to be from Sierra Leone. Next day, the South African came to me to say he was going back to his own country, where he could study much more effectively. Our research students each had their own supervisor, but I tried as far as possible to make sure we all got to know each other, and that students talked to each other, and all the staff, at least in their own discipline. My own study was greatly helped by the kind interest which Besikovic took in me. Besikovic talked to me not only about mathematics, but he also supplied me with some words of wisdom which I want to pass on to you. Well, here's one. He said to me, "You had better get a first-class degree. Of course, if you do not, it can be explained. Almost anything can be explained. But it is better not to have to explain too many things." There was another occasion when he heard that I was about to get married. He said, "In Russia, women love us men to beat them, to show that we love them." Now, in your case, I would not advise that. Well, Besikovic did not only look after me in that kind of way. Dyson wrote to me recently how much he also owed to Besikovic. Well, it is often our wives who generously help to entertain students. My present wife, Wafika, was a student at that time, and she and her sister, Suhaila, frequently entertained other students and visitors. It is unusual for students to show hospitality in this generous way, but it is very much appreciated when they do. I must mention how generously my new colleagues welcomed us and made us feel at home. Jeffrey Stevenson was particularly kind, and his warmth at the beginning of my time here is something I can never forget. Others were less cordial. One said to me, London is different. When you die, I shan't go to your funeral. It did not seem to me that the contingency was imminent, but I felt disinclined to make the experiment. Let us continue with our history. Alas, Salaman Matthews stayed only till 1959. Physics under Blackett was too tempting. But at least we had a future Nobel laureate in our department. Since Nobel most unfairly discriminated against mathematics in his provision, there are not many maths departments which can say that. We were also fortunate to acquire Klaus Roth. I think I would like to put up another slide at this point. This is Roth's theorem. Roth was awarded a Fields Medal at the Edinburgh International Congress in 1958 for his epic work on the approximation of algebraic numbers by rationals. He proved that if alpha is an algebraic number, then alpha cannot be well approximated by rational numbers p over q. In fact, if k is greater than 2, then alpha minus p over q is greater or equal to q to the minus k for all but a finite number of integer pairs pq. Of this work, Siegel has said, as long as men do mathematics, the name of Roth will be remembered. There were problems in University College where Klaus was a professor, and he came to me in 1965 to ask whether he could come over to us. We had been fellow students, that's to say we belonged to the same year in Cambridge, and used to meet on the chessboard where he was number one and I was number nine. He usually beat me in about 4 moves when we had a game together. But at least we had got to know each other a bit. So he came to ask me in 65 whether he could come over to us. There was a deadline. He was going to spend the session 1965-6 at MIT. And if nothing could be fixed in time, he might stay there, as yet another example of the brain drain. There were, however, difficulties at our end. Harry Reuter was coming to us from Durham, partly at Yael Dauker's suggestion. He came to reputedly to escape from being head of department there, but fate caught up with him when he became our head in 1979-83. Also, Clooney was about to be promoted to professor. Could we have 4 professors of pure mathematics, where 10 years earlier there had been none? Fortunately, Lindstedt was still rector and decided that we could, after listening to what Jones and I had to say. I wonder what would happen nowadays in similar circumstances. It seems to me that democracy can be carried too far. A department and an institution benefits enormously by having a genius on its staff, such as Salam and Roth. They attract visitors, staff, and students. They raise the prestige of the whole institution. Even to have their names on the list of staff members makes a difference. Perhaps we in this country do not make enough to keep our great men, our best people here. In one recent year, 4 new mathematical fellows were elected to the Royal Society. All 4 were working in the States. It's not only a question of money. The Americans coddle their great people, give them named or distinguished professorships, generous travel, and other allowances. The Institute for Advanced Study was built on Einstein's reputation. As Orwell has so rightly said, all animals are equal, but some are more equal than others. I was sorry to see Roth go back to University College recently. Perhaps it is a case of on revient toujours à son premier amour. You always come back to your first love. But at least he was with us for 30 years. On the whole, IC has been successful in keeping its best staff here. I am particularly grateful for the institution of senior research fellowships, which help in this respect. In Lehrer's words, it's a case of doing well by doing good. Another genius who spent 5 years with us is James Lighthill, Royal Society Research Professor from 1964 to 69. Dyson and Lighthill were stars ever since they were scholars at Winchester. They came to Cambridge in 1941, trailing clouds of glory and going only to part three lectures, since they had learned all the degree stuff at school. It was reputed that if they forgot to attend tutorials, their supervisor, Besikovich, would forget to charge them. They were elected to the Royal Society at the ages of 28 and 29, respectively. James became Bayer Professor of Applied Mathematics at Manchester at the age of 26, and thereafter Director of the Royal Aircraft Establishment at Farnborough. After that, he came to us, though to be fair, Lighthill was formally attached to one of the engineering departments. Better be honest. I believe that while he was with us, he helped develop Caro's physiological flow unit, which still flourishes. With Fuchs Williams, then a reader in applied mathematics, Lighthill developed the famous eighth power law on the falling away of noise in jets. Alas, we were unable to keep Lighthill for long. He went to be Lucasian professor at Cambridge, a successor of Newton and Dirac. When I asked him whether he couldn't stay a bit longer, he said that his three predecessors had held the chair for a total of 120 years, so he didn't think he would get a second chance. However, he only stayed for 10 years and returned to London as provost of University College. In 1962, the BBC decided to make a series of TV programs about various professions, and one of these was on mathematicians. We must have killed the series because I never heard of another program on those lines. Well, IC was handy around the corner, and so they chose Richard Scorer, then head of our applied maths section, Lighthill, Hilton from Birmingham, and me. There were a few wrinkles. Scorer was a meteorologist interested in cloud formations and tried to get the BBC to go up a mountain in Wales in order to photograph the dawn. Unfortunately, by the time the equipment arrived, the dawn was more or less over. Lighthill was at Heathrow, explaining how quiet he'd made jets, but as a jet was going overhead, it was hard to hear. Peter Hilton claimed that he was leaving his job in Birmingham to make way for an older man. But actually, his successor, Murray McGrath, was younger by 2 months. My accomplishments were illustrated by my cutting the lawn to show that pure maths can be useful. The students must have liked the program, since when I came in next morning, there was a TV box drawn on the blackboard. I also asked, I'm often asked as a pure mathematician, how can you prove that something is not possible? And I think I'd like to show the illustration I gave of this problem. Here is a chessboard, which, as you see, can be covered by 32 rectangles of 2 by 1. I mean, here's an example drawn. Supposing we remove two opposite corners from the chessboard, then there are 62 squares left, and the question is, can that be covered by 31 rectangles of 2 by 1? Well, you probably see the answer, or when you try, you find that you can't do it, so you're convinced. But why can't it be done? Well, the opposite corners have the same color, black or white. If you take out two white squares, you've got 30 white ones and 32 black ones left. And 31 rectangles will cover 31 of each. So that shows that it's not possible. So that's an example of why certain things can't be done. Oh, let's put the time scale on again. Well, I was talking about this TV program. The students must have liked the program because when I came in next morning, there was a TV box drawn on the blackboard. It was certainly a bit better than the 5th of November a few years earlier when I had to leave my lecture because of a series of firecrackers they let off in it. Well, the parts of the program between Lytle and me were linked by a bit of a Mozart piano quartet with James playing the piano. James is infuriating. I mean, he's better at everything. He's a very good pianist and linguist as well. And he swam all the way around the Elbe, apparently, in 24 hours. Well, James was playing the piano. His wife, Nancy, played the cello. My wife, Margaret, played the violin. And my cousin, Dora Hahn, played the viola. And I was allowed to look soulfully at the others. Well, this brings me naturally to music in the department. We had and have several enthusiastic musicians, including Alexandra Mills, a former secretary whom I've already mentioned, Michael Musgrave and others who sang, David Edwards, clarinet, Oliver Pretzel, flute, William Chen, cello, and several pianists, including Noel and Gillian Baker, who not only kept the subject of iteration flying in the UK, but also used to enliven our concerts with playing music. And John Elder, who was a very brilliant pianist. Alexandra used to organize departmental concerts. We used to bribe people to listen by providing a buffet supper in the middle. The second half, after supper, was usually more lighthearted. And I remember an inspired rendering of a Victorian version of a fire with a fire engine on the piano going up and down the keys in a most wonderful way, rendered by John Nelda. Unfortunately, with the departure of Alexandra, there seems to be no one prepared to organize these concerts. Well, in 1964, George Barnett had persuaded the college to buy 5354 Princes Gate, a few houses down from where the Huxley building then was. The building originally housed the statistics section and also contained a very beautiful library which contained a grand piano to match. This was an ideal venue for the early concerts and also the Thursday lunchtime concerts, which are such a pleasant feature of college life. Noel Baker organized these letter concerts for some years. So far, I've talked largely about the early years until 1970, when Harry Jones became pro-rector and so ceased to be head of department. I should say that Harry Jones belongs to a distinguished family. His daughter, Angela Rumbold, was Minister of Education in the Conservative government. Well, not everybody will perhaps approve of that, but anyway, she was a very distinguished woman. And we were very lucky to have Harry, and he moved on to greater things. In the past, there had often been only one professor in a department who was automatically the head. I remember hearing with pleasure and surprise that in 1952, Kurt Mahler had been appointed to a personal professorship at Manchester. Earlier, Newman had been known to boast that he had two assistant lecturers, one of whom, Beniamino Segre, was a full professor at Bologna, and the other, Harold Davenport, was a fellow of the Royal Society. In the 50s and 60s, departments grew, and personal professorships became the norm rather than the exception. I believe that the process of internal promotion can be carried too far, since it inhibits the opportunity departments have for making senior appointments from outside. But multi-professorial departments do allow one a valuable choice for the head of department. George Barnett went to Essex in 1966 and was succeeded by David, later Sir David Cox, probably the best statistician in the UK. Well, the Greeks have said, praise no one till he's dead, or at least till he's gone to Oxford. I believe that Yael Dowker had something to do with this coup as well, since her husband Hugh was a colleague of David's at Birkbeck. Cox soon built up the best statistics group in the country. When he was a student a year ahead of me, he had the reputation of having answered more tripos questions than anybody before or since. In our professorial sessions, David was always extremely fair, the only problem being that one had to work awfully hard to get him to push his own group, since he didn't wish to be biased. David was the natural choice to be Harry Jones' successor in 1970. By then, appointments were only for a fixed period, and heads of department still had the same responsibility. But without the age difference, as in Harry Jones' case, there wasn't quite the same mystique. Problems were argued out either in the professorial committee, especially in the case of promotions, or in departmental meetings. Of course, the department could not make promotions. We could only suggest a number of names to the dean's committee. Perhaps it's worth explaining how the system worked when I was dean of the RCS from 78 to 81, and perhaps still does. The deans of the three colleges were given the lists by various departments of proposed promotions to professor, reader, and senior lecturer, arranged in the department's order of preference. Jealous persons assert that a man becomes a reader if he can't lecture, and a professor if he can't read. Each dean would then look at the lists in his college and make a global list. It's not always easy to compare the merits of a proposed senior lecturer in biochemistry with a proposed professor in hydrodynamics. We used to pay a good deal of attention to the referees' reports, and also to who the referees were. This reminds me of a story that Edre once used to tell. He was asked to referee the promotion of someone and was rather lukewarm. He was surprised to hear a few months later that the man was promoted. He said, "I sent in rather a poor report." "Yes," was the reply. "The report was poor, but it was by such a good referee." All our candidates for promotion were interviewed. The real infighting started when we had to mesh the three lists into a global list in order of merit. On one occasion, the prorector, a mechanical engineer, was not impressed by a case for promotion of a pure mathematician as being insufficiently useful to the world at large. Fortunately, he had to leave for another meeting and the case went through. Apart from promotions, deans didn't do much in my day, and I never did recover who really ran the college. I suspect, however, that it was the rector, secretary, and registrar, the permanent officials. Running a place the size of IC is a full-time business and cannot really be done by people who return to their department as soon as the meeting is over. However, it is very useful to have the input from other people. We had certain heads of departments temporarily on the Dean's Committee, as well as the rector, pro-rectors, secretary of the college, and registrar. Perhaps at this stage, I could say a little about some of the rectors under which I've served. I think I liked Lindstedt best, perhaps because he had the extreme intelligence of appointing me. He was prepared to make bold and sometimes unorthodox decisions. It must be admitted, however, that he had an easier job than some of his successors, since there was so much more money around at that stage. It was, of course, a time of expansion after the Robbins report. After Lindstedt, we had William Penny, Lord Penny. He found life at IC a bit hard, since the academics were an unruly lot, unlike the civil servants at the Atomic Energy Authority, who were more inclined to do what they were told. Things had got steadily worse from the golden days in the past. Johnny Argyris once told me a story of how he bearded Sir Roderick Hill, a former rector, about some complaint or grievance. Hill drew himself up to his full height and replied, "When I was in the Air Force, I was always told that it was up to the officers to command and to the men to obey." Well, unfortunately, staff no longer can be treated in quite that way. After Penny, we had Lord Flowers, Sir Brian Flowers, when he came, from 73 to 85. I found him rather refreshing. He was rude to everybody. There was nothing personal in it. When he first came, he asked me how long I'd been at the college. I said 17 years. Far too long, he replied. It's time you were somewhere else. Being a little slow, it took me 12 years to follow his advice and his footsteps. I left in 85 when he left too. Well, a little later, Flowers visited the department. This department doesn't have the sort of quality I expect in a maths department I see. There are a few good individuals, but where are the groups? Considering that Cox was at that stage building up the strongest statistics group in the country and one of the best in the world, and some of his colleagues such as Stewart in Applied were also doing their little bit, this sounded a bit strange, but Flowers liked to provoke you to answer back. When he was raised to the peerage, he suggested that his title should be Lord Flowers of Brimstone. He had the reputation of being anti-maths, but I feel the department flourished and expanded in his day. In 1983, we had 5 fellows of the Royal Society among our teaching staff of 70. Stewart and Frank Smith in Applied, Cox in Statistics, and Roth and myself in Pure. In 1990, 2 new fellows were in our department, Bob Vaughan, who had been brought here by Klaus Roth in number theory, and Derek Moore in fluid dynamics, and a member of Stewart's group. Flowers had charisma and dynamism. He was succeeded by Sir Eric Ashe. Who was rector from 85 to 93, and since then by Sir Ronald Oxburgh. Sir Eric Ashe is a very polite and hospitable person, but times were leaner in his day and the department contracted. However, I did lure Terry Lyons back from Edinburgh. Terry has built up a formidable group in modern analysis. Under Oxburgh, our department has started to expand again. We have recruited professors and future professors from Cambridge and other foreign eastern places. Imperial College and our department within it is sure to flourish in the next millennium as it is done in the present one. I would like to just finish by putting up our present rector's picture. Sir Ronald Oxburgh. Thank you very much.